Mussorgsky's quintessentially Russian symphonic love song to the Moscow River rises from the stage of the Moscow Conservatory. Summer of 1990, a dramatic time of change, a time that will see the end of the Soviet Union and communism. This orchestra embodies those changes. Half of the musicians are Russian, half are from the United States. 50 gifted artists from each country, survivors and winners in grueling auditions, coming together to share the only language they have in common. These 17 to 24-year-old musicians are part of a unique cultural collaboration, attempting to overcome years of Cold War hostilities and create a single symphony orchestra. Organized by the renowned music schools of Oberlin College, Ohio, and the Moscow State Conservatory, the oldest in their respective nations, the group will rehearse, travel, and perform on a two-month tour that will take them to 21 cities in 8 countries. The task of molding them into a world-class ensemble falls to 3 conductors, 2 from the United States and 1 Russian, Leonard Nikolaev, director of the Moscow Conservatory Symphony.
Очень хорошую, сильную группу привезли. Просто очень сильно, очень профессионально. Вообще приятно с ними работать. И как с профессионалами, и по-человечески. Я с ним в каком-то хорошем таком, вот я, вот это мое ощущение. Я с ним в хорошем контакте с ними работаю. Общаться с таким оркестром, вы знаете, это подзаряжает очень. Это сохраняет в тебе молодость музицирования. Какой-то такой, знаете, обновленный, как будто сбрасывает с себя лет 20-30.
Russians expect us to be firm, and that's kind of the social way to be. So for us, it's a learning experience of and realizing how it is really difficult for our nations to work together because we're such a different people.
Well, I'm a cellist, and so in the cello section, each of us has a Soviet stand partner. So it's been quite an interesting thing trying to communicate, trying to understand what they're trying to say to you and what you're trying to get across to them. So I was really fortunate, though. I don't speak Russian, but I can pretty understand what people are saying. And my stand partner doesn't speak English at all, but he can sort of understand what I'm saying. So all I do, if I just keep speaking English and he just keeps speaking Russian, then we're all fine.
I love him.
Oh, I see. So he brought you the tapes from the U.S.?
Я не понимаю. I don't know, understand.
But you can't buy them here.
I can speak free word. thank you. Play. I don't know. Understand.
Nikolaya's responsibilities are shared by French-born Catherine Comey, director of the Grand Rapids and American Symphony Orchestras. Each country has its own musical style, so the conductor's talents will be challenged to bring to the stage the two different styles as one.
Moscow Conservatory alone, or all the forces of the United States alone, could have put together an orchestra this quality. Why? Our wind players are simply stronger than theirs, as a school. And the brasses, the same way, percussion. Their string players are phenomenal. I mean, this cello section, Catherine Comey, she said there's not a major orchestra in the world that wouldn't envy this cello section.
Советском Союзе и в Соединенных Штатах Америки немножко разная система подготовки музыкантов. Вот. Советские музыканты, как любой профессии, они стремятся всегда с детства быть солистами. И они мало времени уделяют, скажем, оркестровой игре, а если уделяют, то недостаточно серьезно к этому относятся. Американцы же наоборот, при том, что они тоже, разумеется, хотят, многие из них хотят быть солистами, они очень серьезно относятся к игре в оркестре, потому что везде, в любой стране, солистам быть очень трудно.
Joshua Bell is a 22-year-old soloist with the orchestra. As a 14-year-old, he performed with the Philadelphia Orchestra. A year later, he debuted at Carnegie Hall.
First of all, I love going on a tour anytime we can play something over and over again, because and I get to travel with the orchestra. Normally, I go somewhere and I meet an orchestra and I rehearse maybe once, and we play sometimes only one concert, maybe two or three, but that's the extent of it. Here, I'm living and eating with the players, and so when we're out there, I feel it's all my friends back there, and we're really making chamber music more than just playing a concert.
Part of the tour is the soon-to-be independent Baltic republics of Latvia and Estonia, the first cracks in the foundation of the Soviet state.
tour has actually just started taking shape. It's been very exciting. We traveled, it's hard to remember where we've traveled so far. We went from Moscow to Tallinn, then to Pärnu, which was just a beautiful, beautiful place. That was the first beach we went to. And now here we are in Jurmala. It's been incredible already. We've only been really on the road for 4 days and it's just flown by. It's amazing to be in different places every day.
Musicians are beginning to realize the grueling schedule they will face over the next 6 weeks.
I think the whole tour is a very consuming event mentally, both because of the music, we're here to work, and then as diplomats it just takes a lot of energy and get really tired. So by the end of the summer I think I will be exhausted.
In the process of teaching the orchestra to play together, the conductor rehearses each section individually, helping them to learn their part.
Very good, you have very good quarter notes.
Звучит па па. Вот этот же отзвук должен быть в первой восьмушке. И раз. И не спешите спокойно. Больше. Больше. Конечно.
We were eating dinner one night, and through a translator, a Russian girl, a Russian violinist in the orchestra, told me that she never knew that a girl could play bassoon so well. She's never seen a woman play the bassoon before.
She's never, yeah. And for us, that would be a big insult in
the
States.
Yeah, if somebody in the United States said that to us, we'd get upset. But coming from a Russian, it just kind of epitomizes what it's like to be a woman in Russia and a musician in Russia, I guess, as well.
It's a lot of fun, though.
Yeah.
We're really getting along.
Leningrad, formerly Königsberg, capital of East Prussia, and birthplace of philosopher Immanuel Kant. The city was utterly destroyed in World War II and taken over by the Soviets, who closed it to foreigners. The American musicians are the first to visit Kaliningrad in 45 years, another sign of the changing times.
First trumpet is Russian, and he's a real good player. The style is different. We were playing Symphonie Fantastique, and the big trumpet section in there is kind of like bouncy. It's bumpy, bumpy. And the way that his style would tell him to play it was beam ba 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 beam ba ba ba. And it's, you know, the three of us and the one of him, it doesn't really match. So we need to get together and, you know, find a common style that we can all play so that it will sound good in concert.
Soviet state-owned company Gosconcert is managing the tour within the USSR. Their decision to fly the Americans out of Kaliningrad and ship the Russians on the cheap by train is not well received.
Они считают нас, что мы еще маленькие детки, и мы ничего не понимаем, и что на нас можно грабить как угодно. Между прочим, у многих есть семьи и которым нужно как-то жить, а у студентов стипендия небольшая.
Куда нас пихнут, то мы слопаем вроде того, что. Вот что запихнули нас в эти вонючие вагоны. Что это?
Нет,
американцы летят на самолете. Конечно, я ничего не против них, но это.
Они в этом совершенно не виноваты. Они сами возмущаются, что существует такое разделение. Да, они, может быть, даже
вчера один парень,
нас, да.
Этот Натан, очень сильно возмущался по этому поводу. Что мы, он говорит, что мы думали, что мы будем все вместе.
А нам объяснили это так, как в Калининграде нет горючего в аэропортах.
Ну да.
Но, тем не менее, для американцев оно нашлось. А для нас нет.
Ребята американцы сами возмущались тем, что произошло такое разделение.
Ну, на американцев, да, просто две группы оркестра. Слушай, для одной группы нашлось, а для другой не нашлось. Вот для половины оркестра нашлось горючее, а для второй половины не нашлось. А говорить, что американцы, не американцы, мы все люди, в принципе.
Нет, мы не люди. Это сказал представитель Госконцерта. Он сказал, что... Я его спросил, скажите, пожалуйста, а когда мы будем жить как люди в отеле? Он говорит, вы знаете, вы не люди, вы студенты. Понимаешь, этим все сказано.
Вот и все.
Weimar, home of the poet Goethe, formerly East Germany, is now part of a newly reunified Germany. The Americans express their feelings about leaving the Soviet Union behind.
How does everyone feel about getting out of the Soviet Union and coming to Germany?
Very good. The truth be told, just look around.
Well, it's a different feeling. It's like tons of pressure is just off. I mean, it was great being there, experiencing the culture and all that, and being with the people. The Russian musicians are really sad that we were leaving now, because, I mean, I didn't even think about it, but when we were saying goodbye, they were really sad because it was the last time they were going to see us there.
18, 19, 21.
The site of one of Nazi 22. Germany's horror camps, Buchenwald, lies within walking distance of a cultivated Weimar. Despite their grinding schedule, some of the musicians find time to visit and ponder.
Ну, вообще очень страшное место, конечно. И просто какое-то оцепенение. Мои впечатления. Жаль, что на нас очень мало времени. Но то, что мы видели, это, конечно, ужасно.
Chamber music groups provide another ensemble opportunity for the musicians. From the Germany of unrealized socialism to the Germany of full-blown capitalism, the tour continues across Europe. In Hamburg, conductor Leonard Slatkin joins the team. Slatkin directs and conducts the 100-year-old St. Louis Symphony, and guest conducts throughout the world. American-born with Russian forebears, he bridges the symphony's two musical worlds.
Feel okay? The beginning for me, very slow.
Начало очень медленно.
In 8.
На 8.
After the first bar,
после первого такта,
give me a little bit of a breath.
Немножко запятая.
Okay?
Маленький. What a good conductor, and it's what a pleasure for me. I work with him, and he very good musician. And when he work with the orchestra, it's very interesting music interpretation. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And may I say one funny word? Yes, Slatkin in Russian. Words we have, we say slatko, it is the sweet chocolate, slatko, and slatki, sweet conductor.
It's amazing, it's wonderful.
Who is?
Slatkin. He's turned the orchestra around for the better. The first rehearsal he conducted yesterday, I mean, it just sounded like a totally different group. It was amazing. He really knows what he's doing. He shows everything in his hands and his body. He needs very few words. He's by far, I would say, the best American conductor.
In Hamburg, a simmering discontent comes to a boil. Some Russian musicians believe they should be given opportunities to solo. The talented principal cellist Pyotr Mezvinsky and his stand partner boycott a concert.
Last night, the cellist and his stand partner boycotted the concert, which I thought was really crappy. Makes me and a whole bunch of other people feel really lousy.
Their boycott creates a serious division within the orchestra. But the Russians think they are only exercising their newfound right to express themselves. This display of independence would never have happened a year earlier. In Copenhagen, tensions continue. Tour management remains unresponsive, and the two cellists raise the stakes. The concertmaster announces that they intend to leave the tour and go home.
I'm not sure, but I think that the two people may be returning to the Soviet Union and no longer continuing the tour with the orchestra. And I also found myself faced with that choice just before the concert yesterday evening. Please shut the door.
Maestro Slatkin intervenes. He proposes a committee of musicians on both sides of the controversy to meet and try to resolve the conflict.
I think what you're seeing are these two very disparate musical backgrounds reacting now as an orchestra, reacting almost in a way that has become more universal. They're literally forming a little union among themselves. It's quite remarkable when you think about it. They are dealing with it as orchestra committees, as units that you see in the professional circles now. This has to be a somewhat new situation for the Russian musicians, certainly. But they're also part of the people who are instigating this idea of having the discussions and presenting the issue to the administration. It's exactly what you would see in the professional circumstance. So they see a problem, and they're trying to handle it from within to prevent it from becoming a greater problem. It's very interesting. Now, I don't know quite yet what the result will be. If I do my job right, no matter what the decision is, they'll all live with it comfortably, as I wound up telling them. I said sometimes one has to make sacrifices, but that ultimately it's the music that's the most important thing, and what you have to do first and foremost is to think what's best for the music.
That evening, differences in language and musical styles fade away as the musicians put the music first. overnight train to Amsterdam, the committee manages to hammer out a compromise of sorts. No additional solos, but more concertizing in small chamber groups. Amsterdam provides a new mood for the orchestra. The Russian first cellist, mollified if not satisfied, agrees to stay with a tour.
Well, actually, everything is pretty much normalizing. In any large group of people, especially a group with people from mixed nations.
Естественно, могут возникать проблемы.
It's just a natural fact that problems can exist.
Это естественный процесс.
It's just a natural process.
Не может все идти гладко.
Nothing can always be completely without problems.
Но приятно то, что они совместными усилиями разрешаются.
It's nice that though that the problems are resolved in a joint type way.
Мы все хотим, чтобы их не было.
We all want the problems to disappear.
Чтобы оркестр существовал в полном составе.
We want the orchestra to exist in its entirety.
Играл лучше.
To play better.
Amsterdam offers a serious challenge for the orchestra, an opportunity to perform and record a CD for BMG Records in the Concertgebouw, one of the most famous concert halls in the world.
Historic halls in the world. One that's generally held up to be an example of a truly great hall. It's okay. This is nothing serious here. I was talking about your hall.
I like to hear that.
Because, you know, no matter what, I think part of the excitement of an evening is that here are all these young people playing in this hall where it's not even just a question of the history, but the fact that it sounds so good anyway. I mean, it doesn't matter all the people that have been here before to the orchestra. They're too young. But I know I'm standing where Mahler stood. And, you know, it's not so easy. It's not so easy to do that.
5 minutes, everybody. Yes. That's
for us to go.
Are
we ready?
Okay.
I need to close the door.
It's bad luck otherwise. Mm-hmm. Okay.
No, I always close my own door. It's one of the things.
Tell Dima this is a very special hall. I need him to sit in his seat, and then I will signal him from up top on stage left. I will signal him to tune. Okay. No. From the top. The conductor will make a grand entrance down there.
Musicians find enormous inspiration here as they perform to a full house which applauds every piece with a standing ovation. Los Angeles, movie capital of the world, the first taste of America for the Russians, and a welcome sight for the travel-weary Americans.
Well, I'm pleased that at least now you got an idea of what the Southern California weather is supposed to be. Because yesterday it was much more like my home in St. Louis. Okay. So now it's time to work very hard for the new pieces. So, Schwanter.
The orchestra will perform Schwantner's piece, New Morning for the World. Its unusual rhythms and tonalities are set to the words of Dr. Martin Luther King. Slatkin has chosen this piece believing that Dr. King's words hold an important message about freedom and democracy for the musicians. The piece will first be performed at the Hollywood Bowl with James Earl Jones reading the words of Dr. King.
We are going to walk non-violently and peacefully to let the nation and the world know that we are tired now. We've lived with slavery and segregation 345 years. We waited a long time for freedom.
It's so important, though, that this orchestra has chosen to focus on this man's words, because I can't think of all those assassinations that happened during our time, my time. There is not a voice that we need more desperately than his.
Now is the time to make real the promise of democracy. Now is the time to rise from the dark and desolate valley of segregation to the sunlit path of racial justice. Now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksands of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. Now is the time to make justice a reality to all God's children.
When I took on the task of conducting the Soviet American Youth Orchestra, I actually insisted that we do something that would take the combination of Soviet youngsters and American youngsters out of the context of music and put them into a situation where they would have something to talk about, perhaps a common bond other than the music. Fortunately, it's the music that brought us together, the words of Dr. King placed in this really lovely and moving piece of music. And we have even gone so far as to have not just a translation for the Soviet kids, but a person read in Russian the words as the music was being played. And I think the Soviets got as much out of it, and perhaps even more than our American colleagues did.
By a special act of Congress, the orchestra will be allowed to perform on the Capitol lawn, becoming for an evening a living monument to the new age of East-West relations.
The best thing I can tell you from experience with this piece is don't try to recreate King.
Okay,
Try to go with what the words take you into.
Yeah, okay.
We find that's the most effective one.
Okay, it is my very great pleasure to introduce to you yet another version of how this piece will go, and certainly just as interesting. This is Charles Dutton, ladies and gentlemen.
We are on the move now. Neither the burning of our churches nor the beating and killing of our clergymen will stop us. We're on the move now. My people, listen. The battle is in our hands. I know some of you are asking, how long will it take? I come to you to say, however difficult the moment, however frustrating the hour, it will not be long because truth, pressed to the earth, will rise again. How long? Not long because no lie can live forever. How long? Not long because you will reap what you sow. How long? Not long because the arm of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice.
By the tour's end, the orchestra has traveled on 24 trains, 110 buses, 16 planes, and 3 ships. No one could count the hours of rehearsal or measure the intensity of effort that had enabled them to transcend the barriers of different language, culture, and musical training to become, in a few short weeks, a world-class orchestra. The musicians head home exhausted, but enriched by an experience that can never be duplicated. As they return home, they are unaware of the tremendous world changes that will sweep across their lives in the months ahead. For the Russians, the tour will become the overture to the end of the Soviet Union. The words of Martin Luther King will prove to be prophetic. They were on the move now, and the changes were just beginning.